if you don't find the solution, you have no proof that there is no solution. Do you understand what I'm saying? What is the reason, you know, when if I just go into my room and looking for something, I just randomly look all over the place and I find it, nobody is going to complain. Rao, you didn't look carefully. Why do you care? I found it. Right? If I just randomly looked and looked at the same thing many, many, many times and then came out and said it's not there, my wife will say, you didn't look carefully. And she will be right. Right? Because she will then go and systematically check and find it. You see what I'm saying? Right? That's the problem. That's the point about local search. It basically, when it wins, it wins. When it loses, you have no proof whatsoever. But search is important, you know, in terms of actually when it fails too, because when it says there's no solution, it better be a proof that there is no solution. And as I mentioned in 471, actually, if you think of theorem proving versus model finding, so SAT is model finding. Given a set of constraints, find me a model for the constraints. That's a CSP problem. Theorem proving is given a set of constraints, is the particular fact F true? Does it follow? That's theorem proving. Okay? It turns out you can convert it into a SAT, you know, constraint satisfaction problem. You say C and not F. See if there is a model. If there's a model, then it's not a theorem. If there's no model, then it's a theorem. If there is no world in which all these constraints hold and this fact holds, then, if there is no world in which all the constraints hold and the fact does not hold, then it is true that the fact is entailed by the constraints. Even if there is one world where the constraints hold but the fact doesn't hold, then the fact is not entailed by the constraints. So when I convert it into CSP, then I just have to solve this problem, C and not F, except I'm not hoping now to find a solution. I'm hoping not to find a solution. But then when I'm hoping not to find a solution, I better have a proof that when I did not find a solution, it's not because I didn't even start my search algorithm. It's because the search algorithm went through the entire search space and found there's no solution. That's where basically, you know, you cannot use local search for entailment computation. You have to use systematic search. Okay, when we come back next class, we want to talk about why are CSP problems hard at all? We want to look at theory of why do CSP problems become hard. And as I mentioned last class, a CSP problem won't be hard if you don't have to backtrack. So, if I pick an order of variables and give the first variable a value, second variable a value, there's always going to be a value for the third variable, let's say. Then I know that I never have to backtrack over the third variable's assignment. A CSP where you never have to backtrack, you know, when you are given a partial assignment that is correct for k variables and a k plus one variable, you can always give a value to the k plus one variable without having to undo anything you have done to the k variables. That is considered k plus one consistent. Okay? And a CSP is considered inconsistent. That means if you can take any n minus 1 partial assignment and can extend it to any nth variable. And a CSP is considered strongly inconsistent if it is 1 consistent, 2 consistent, 3 consistent, all the way to inconsistent. If you are given a CSP which is inconsistent, strongly inconsistent, then you don't have to do such. Because you can pick a variable, give it a value. Then you can pick any other variable. Because it's too consistent, you should be able to give it a value. Now you have two variables with a value. Then you should be able to pick any third variable and you should be able to give it a value because it's three consistent. And so on all the way to the end. So the notion of k-consistency winds up being a useful way to understand when are CSP problems easy to solve. A particular CSP problem may not be inconsistent, but it may be, let's say, three consistent. So it would be better than not at all being consistent. And one of the things you'll see, for example, forward checking does is it essentially enforces a partial notion of two consistency. And for two consistency, we use the term arc consistency. We'll talk about all of this when we come back.